Hello, and welcome to this first lecture on psychosis. This is Dr. Nicholas Hatcher, and in this presentation, we will examine the history, definition, and epidemiology of psychosis. This will be the first in a series of lectures designed to explore the etiology, epidemiology, pathophysiology, diagnosis, and management of psychosis. Here I've provided an outline of this lecture series with key foci and a brief description of each component of this lecture series. As we progress through, we will use this as a general outline. Let's begin with some history of psychosis. Emil Kraepelin was the first to describe the psychosis phenomenon as dementia praecox. He recognized a neurodegenerative nature of individuals with a primary psychosis and likened the cognitive dysfunction with those individuals suffering from dementia. Eugene Bleuler was the first to define the term schizophrenia, a term which means split mind. Schizophrenia was then seen as a splitting of the cognitive, emotional, and behavioral aspects, or fragmentation of the self, which resulted in altered perception, inappropriate behavior and feelings, withdrawal from reality, and personal relationships into fantasy and delusion, and a sense of mental fragmentation. Bleuler was also the first to identify categories of symptoms that we now commonly use today. These include positive symptoms, symptoms that are exaggerated normal processes, such as hallucinations and delusions, and negative symptoms, symptoms that reflect a diminishment in a normal process, such as amotivation, anergia, and apathy. Kurt Schneider claimed that 9 groups of psychotic manifestations, designated as first-rank symptoms, had a decisive weight in the diagnosis of schizophrenia. These include the following: audible thoughts, voices arguing about or discussing the patient, voices commenting on the patient's actions, experiences of influences on the body, thought withdrawal, and other interference with thought, thought broadcast or diffusion of thought, delusional perception, and other experiences involving quote-unquote made impulses and feelings experienced as caused by an outside agency. This ultimately contributed to some of the basis of the DSM and ICD-10 criteria for the diagnosis of schizophrenia. In a clinical tradition aiming to group psychotic illnesses on the basis of presumed localized cerebral dysfunction, Carl Leonard developed an elaborate classification of the endogenous psychoses, which departed substantially from Kraepelin and Bleuler's nosology. Leonard defined sharply delineated disease entities, described by a detailed psychopathology emphasizing objective signs, for instance, psychomotor behavior, course and outcome, and family history. The non-affective psychoses were split into systemic and unsystemic groups of schizophrenias, and a third group of cycloid psychoses, each containing further subtypes, for which Leonard claimed distinct categorical disease status. While the unsystemic schizophrenias were considered to be primarily genetic, hereditary factors were thought to play a secondary role in the cycloid psychoses and the systematic schizophrenias, which were presumed to be exogenously determined, for instance, by maternal obstetric complications or early failure in social learning. Additional approaches to the classification of psychotic disorders is listed here as well. Although the DSM-5 contains specific criteria for illnesses with psychotic symptoms, there is still much debate over the nature of psychosis, how we define it, and how we classify it. For the purpose of this lecture series, I feel it is appropriate to move forward with a working definition of psychosis as a general concept. This will allow us to apply the concept to a variety of subpopulations where the condition is present. Therefore, Psychosis is a condition of disrupted boundaries within the self and between self and others, with consequent fragmentation of the self and reality. The symptoms of psychosis reflect adaptive attempts to protect the self, as well as measures to repair the fragmentation of self and reality. Most broadly, the psychotic syndrome requires a diathesis or vulnerability and a stress. In other words, there is some predisposing factor invariably present that, when excited by some form of stressor, results in activation of the psychotic condition and consequent symptoms. Psychosis exists on a continuum between adaptive and maladaptive, and is a complex phenomenon best understood from a biopsychosocial perspective. As I alluded to in the previous slide, not all psychosis is schizophrenia, and in fact, at times psychosis is a normal phenomenon. Several psychoanalysts emphasize this point. For instance, Harry Sullivan said, "When we are born, we are all psychotic." In the observation of an infant, one will recognize the lack of constructed boundaries within the self and between self and others. This is part of the normal developmental process, as these boundaries are understood to develop over time. This was also recognized by Donald Winnicott, who said there's no such thing as a baby. Here, Winnicott emphasizes a crucial point in the understanding of psychological development of children and the interaction between the child and mother. A baby essentially exists as part of the mother-infant unit, where the mother and child become fused as one unit. The mother ultimately becomes the first conceptualization of pleasure and unpleasure, safety and security, trust and mistrust. Sigmund Freud provided two additional examples. He explained that when we dream, we are all psychotic. This was through the recognition of the parallel between mechanisms of dreams and the mechanisms of psychosis. As an example, a mechanism recognized in dreams is condensation. This is where two objects are merged into one. You can probably recall a time where you had a dream where, for instance, you saw your husband, but he did not look like your husband, but instead like your father. Mechanisms such as this were found to be present in psychosis. Sigmund Freud also said that being in love is akin to being psychotic. Here he was emphasizing the point that there is a degree of ego boundary dissolution between two lovers, leading to somewhat of a fusion between the two individuals. Psychosis can take us to the edge of what is possible in human experience. There is a unification of dialectics that is best exemplified through thinking of an artistic process. Where there is chaos and order, there is fluidity and rigidity. There is fusion and separation. While the remainder of this lecture series will emphasize the maladaptive end of the psychotic spectrum, recognize that there are shades of gray amidst the dichotomous extremes. Now let's turn to the more maladaptive end of the psychosis spectrum and some related epidemiologic data. The prototypical enduring psychotic illness is schizophrenia. These data are derived primarily from studies of patients who met criteria for schizophrenia according to the DSM. While approximately 20% of the general population experiences transient psychotic experiences, indicating that psychosis exists on a spectrum, schizophrenia has a lifetime prevalence of 0.3 to 0.7%. It affects greater than 21 million people worldwide. The condition affects males more commonly than females, with approximately 12 million affected males and 9 million affected females. Schizophrenia is typically diagnosed in the late teens to early 30s and tends to emerge earlier in males, late adolescence to early 20s, than females, early 20s to early 30s. This condition accounts for 15 to 45% of the homeless population. This phenomenon is described by the downward drift hypothesis, where symptoms of psychosis, especially cognitive and interpersonal, contribute to difficulty in climbing the socioeconomic ladder, thus resulting in a downward drift. Here I've provided some prevalence estimates, which provides an interesting view on the genetic nature of schizophrenia. The highest risk occurs among two affected parents and monozygotic twins. A key observation here is that if schizophrenia, as well as other psychotic illnesses, were in fact primarily hereditary, one would expect to see a higher percentage of affected individuals as genetic risk increases. This is not the case. Therefore, significant attention has been given to the environmental factors and epigenetic phenomena that may contribute to the development of psychosis. We will discuss these environmental factors in a separate lecture. Individuals with an enduring psychotic illness have an increased risk of premature mortality to the point that patients are 2 to 2.5 times more likely to die early compared with the general population due to physical illness. The estimated average potential life lost for individuals with schizophrenia in the United States is 28.5 years. Co-occurring medical conditions such as heart disease, liver disease, and diabetes contribute to the higher premature mortality rate among individuals with schizophrenia. Up to 80% of these individuals have a significant concurrent medical illness, and greater than 50% are not receiving appropriate care. Possible reasons for this excess early mortality are increased rates of these medical conditions and under-detection or under-treatment of them. Additional psychiatric comorbidities include substance use disorders, with 50% using tobacco, anxiety disorders, especially OCD and panic disorder. An enduring psychotic illness is occasionally preceded by schizotypal or paranoid personality disorder. Up next, we will discuss the predisposing factors for psychosis from a biological, psychological, and philosophical perspective. For downloadable content such as written notes, PowerPoint slides, and more related to this lecture series, please visit my website using the link below. You can also support my goal of continuing to provide new content through Patreon, where becoming a patron will provide you with access to downloadable content as I create new content. Thank you for your support. This concludes this first lecture. Here are my references for this presentation. Thank you for listening.